Welcome students. Today we are going to discuss about benign prostatic hyperplasia. This topic is very crucial from your examination point of view, both for descriptive as well as for competitive. First, we'll have a look at the etiological factors. This disease is most commonly seen beyond 50 years of age. At 60 years, approximately 50% of the patients will have histological evidence, that is microscopic evidence of this disease. 15% of the patients will suffer significant urinary symptoms at this particular age. There are few hormones which play important role. As the age advances, the testosterone effect will go down and there will be weak estrogenic effect that will coming up. Because of this, there is a change in the prostatic architecture. Plus, intermediate peptide growth factors are also contributory towards development of benign prostatic hyperplasia, henceforth will be referred as BPH. We'll have a quick look at the anatomy of the prostate for better understanding of the various pathophysiological aspects of this disease. There is one picture which will give you a better idea. In the first half of this picture, we'll give you in profile relative description about the urinary bladder, the site and location of the prostate, and the capsules or coverings. As you are aware, prostate is situated at the bladder neck, and the portion of urethra commencing from the bladder neck till the urogenital diaphragm is considered as a prostatic urethra. Prostate has two capsules. One is a true capsule which is adjacent to the gland, and one is a false capsule which is at a distance from the gland. There is venous plexus at the bladder neck, which is very important. All these aspects are very important for better understanding during the surgical removal of this gland. There is in between a zone in the prostatic urethra which is called as veromontanum, which is a zone from where there will be secretions getting collected from the seminal vesicles into the prostatic urethra. The second diagram will give you an overview about the various zones in the prostate gland. There are two main zones for simplicity. One is the inner zone versus outer zone. In technical terms, we call it as a central zone against a peripheral zone. Now, in between the central zone and a peripheral zone, there is a small portion which cannot be exactly distinguished, but we call it as a transitional zone. So this picture will give you the central portion is a prostatic urethra. This is taken in the horizontal plane, which is surrounded by the inner zone. Now this inner zone, why we are talking, this is zone which getting affected during the BPH process, and this is what causes compression on the prostatic urethra. Now this is also called as the central zone, which goes along with the transitional zone, and there is outer zone which is prone for development of malignancy or carcinoma of the prostate, which is also called as a peripheral zone. So this periurethral zone or transitional zone constitutes mainly the BPH or houses the BPH, and it is 85% of the times. Pathology. There are two main changes that occur in the prostate gland. One is the stromal proliferation or change in the prostatic parenchyma, and second is organic change. In stromal proliferation, what we see, there are four different types of changes occur. One is fibroadenomatous, second is fibromuscular, third is adenomatous, and fourth is fibrous. Organic changes, there will be condensed peripheral zone, which is called, we call it as a pseudocapsule formation during the enlargement of the prostate, and displacement of varium. The sphincter gets thus stretched. These are the primary changes what we have discussed. Now we'll go on to the secondary changes that are associated with BPH. The changes occur in the gland as well as structure adjacent to the gland, that is urinary bladder. Now in the bladder, what all changes can occur? There can be detrusor hypertrophy, there can be urethral obstruction, there can be detrusor atonia, and there can be trabeculations. These all changes occur within the urinary bladder. And there are few neurological changes that are also seen with this pathology. There are two receptors, one is alpha receptor and a beta receptors. Now alpha receptors, they contribute towards the tonicity of the bladder, and beta receptors are for relaxation of the detrusor muscles or the sphincter. So here what happens, there is a change. What we have seen is a conversion of beta 2 to alpha 1. This is what actually causes main problem functionally to us, that the detrusor relaxation is little less and causes hypertrophy, and there is decrease in the tonicity of the bladder. So all these pathological changes will give rise to various clinical features to us. For simplicity, these clinical features have been classified into two broad categories. One is obstructive type and one is irritative types. Obstructive types, what all the patient can present to you with? First and foremost is a hesitancy. To start, patient will be hesitant to start the urine stream. Second thing, because of the stretching of the varu, there will be narrowing of the urethra, which will give rise to a poor flow of urine. Because of the narrowness of the urethral diameter, there will be intermittency or intermittent stream. Patient will have a sensation of poor bladder emptying because complete bladder evacuation is not possible in the single episode. Something that gets retained in the bladder. And what the patient mentions to us is episode of near retention, not absolute retention. The irritative symptoms occur. These symptoms occur usually earlier. That is the frequency. The first symptom to appear, nocturia, urgency, urge incontinence, and enuresis, that is waking up in the night. So these patients usually complain to us with symptoms that is going to disturb their sleep pattern totally, and they become more irritative. That is why we call it as irritational symptoms. That is what bothers their daily lifestyle or behavior. Now depending on the symptoms, there are scoring systems that are available. There are two broad scoring systems what we have taken care of, that is IPSS and AUA. Now IPSS is International Prostate Symptom Scoring System, which classifies the prostate severity clinical score into three zones: mild, moderate, and severe. 0 to 7 score is considered as a mild. The importance of knowing the scoring system is we can plan our treatment option for the patient. For mild variant, we can be just observant. It is called as waitful watch. Second zone in which the score is 8 to 20, which is a moderate zone, which warrants some form of a drug treatment, pharmacological or a medical treatment. We call it as a conservative treatment. And lastly, severe form, that is more than 20 a score goes, it requires a surgical intervention or some form of a surgical treatment. It can be endoscopic or open surgery. American guidelines or American Urological Association has given a different guideline. The score is a little different. Less than 9 is considered mild, which will be observant zone. 9 to 16 will be medical treatment, and more than 16 score will require definitive surgical treatment. Now, after knowing the scoring system, we move on to various treatment options. The treatment options, as we have already discussed in brief, are medical treatment, that is a pharmacological treatment, against semi-conservative or endoscopic treatment, against definitive surgical treatment. So we first start with a conservative treatment. In conservative treatment, there are a few things we should look for. First is the usage of alpha blockers, which are of two types, non-selective versus selective. Non-selective, such as phenoxybenzamine and phentolamine. But what we prefer is a selective blockage. We don't want total alpha blockade, but we want alpha 1 blockade. So alpha 1 blockade will be achieved through prazosin, terazosin, and alfuzosin. Second, what we use is 5 alpha reductase inhibitor, which basically what basic treatment is done is the conversion of testosterone into dihydrotestosterone is inhibited through finasteride. Third is the LHRH analogs with the use of buserelin, and lastly plant alkaloids with the use of phytosteroids. Further, pharmacologically, we can use steroidal antiandrogens such as cyproterone acetate and certain non-steroidal antiandrogens such as flutamide. After the surgical or the then we will go to the surgical treatment. Medical treatment, we have to weigh. We usually give for 3 months period and we observe patient's response. If patient is not responding to medical treatment or shows very good signs of regression of the symptoms, then we wait for at least a month. We keep the patient under observation and we call the patient for regular follow-up. During follow-up, we can see once we have stopped the medical line, how long patient can bear with this, or patient requires further treatment. Now suppose patient requires second episode of this treatment, then we have to judge whether this patient is a good candidate for surgery or still we can give one more cycle of conservative line for the patient. So in surgery, what are options we have? Previously, there was only open option available to us, that is open surgical prostate treatment. So there were various prostatectomies were advised by various people. Millins first performed retropubic prostatectomy, then Harris performed a suprapubic type, Freyers was a transvesical approach, and Young's was a perineal approach. Out of this, Millins, Harris, Freyers, and Young's, Harris's and Young's treatment is now obsolete. We don't use it anymore. Few senior urologists or senior surgeons still perform Millins or sometimes transvesical, that is Freyer's prostatectomy, for a very large prostate load. So the size usually for a normal prostate in a normal human being is up to 25 grams. So when it increases beyond that, that is it goes say 50 grams, still we can go for medical line of treatment. But if the size goes beyond 100 grams, there is no point wasting time on simple medical line of treatment. We have to take our decision and we have to evaluate the patient and we have to counsel the patient for surgery. So these patients are the candidates for such surgeries. But now with the advent of endoscopy, these again two methods have become more obsolete. Endoscopically, now the gold standard treatment for BPH is TURP, that is transurethral resection of prostate. It is done totally through cystoscopic approach, where the entire prostate is visualized, both the median lobes are evaluated, and again the urethra is restored, which is compressed by the two median lobes. Second thing, what we do, you can do a transurethral incision on prostate, in which not much to be needed, but one needs to make a simple incision and remove central core portion of the enlarged prostate gland. There are special newer methods available to us, such as use of lasers. Now, laser stands for light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. Now, this technology is used very wisely and we have to use it with caution. That is transurethral laser incision of prostate or TULIP treatment is offered. Now, this treatment is an OPD treatment or OPD based regime in which patient can come to you on OPD basis, can be subjected depending on the fitness, and patient can go home within few hours. So this is a day care surgery type of procedure, which is good, but we have to tell patient that patient has to be fit medically to undergo this treatment for day care surgery. because the earlier we send patient, the fitter we require the patient. Second is transurethral needle ablation. Now here the gland is enlarged, but not so enlarged so as to cause obstructive symptoms. So we do various needle ablations at various points and evaporate the zones. So it will get the urethra will get open. Third is a microwave. Microwave energy is used to ablate the enlarged prostate gland. Previously, few people advocated the cryotherapy, but it is not so popular modality of treatment. Then few situations we need to do a simple dilatation. This is usually done in very earlier form of prostate between 50 to 100 gram when the urologist will perform a cystoscopy and will take a judgment whether this particular patient is going to require TURP or a simple dilatation can achieve the results. Because what we need is good passage for outflow of urine. That is what is important and that is the main aim in this. So TUBD, that is transurethral balloon dilatation, is achieved. Lastly, patients who are unfit for surgery, patients who are bedridden in ICU, patients who are debilitated, cannot actually undergo either form of treatment, either endoscopic or for surgical, open surgery. So for them, what we do is minimum, but same time should produce good results. So we use stents or various coils so as to keep this particular urethra patent without doing much resection for the prostate. Because no, even if you do little dissection, it is going to cause some sort of a morbidity for the patient. So we do very little for the patient and achieve good results through putting just stents. But this is again a form of palliative treatment and not a definitive treatment. Now, TURP, which is now is a gold standard treatment for BPH, can have various complications. Plus, there can be other problems that are technology related. So we'll study what things can happen with this modality of treatment. Because it is very important before you offer any treatment to the patient, patient should be well aware of the side effects with the treatment. So first we'll see the general complications. General complications, most dreaded one are the cardiovascular options, in which there can be basal lung atelectasis or there can be basal lung failure in simple words, in which there can be some collection in the lower zone and patient may have difficulty in breathing. Few patients may develop pneumonia. Few patients can have heart attacks or in technological terms myocardial infarctions. Few patients may have an overload due to water and have congestive cardiac failure. Few patients due to prolonged procedure may have deep vein thrombosis. Then there can be water intoxication. Previously, as you are aware, this TURP requires continuous irrigation for the channel. And these patients, if you use simple water, which was previously used, what the surgeon is to do? Put a bucket of water, which is at quite height, and just pour boiled water into it and use it for channel for irrigation. So the vision is kept clear continuously during the cystoscopic evaluation and during the surgery. Now this water caused a lot of problem because of the retention into the body. So this side effect can be minimized with the usage of isotonic glycine solution. So we don't use the conventional bucket option, but we use the other option of using isotonic glycine. The next complication what one can encounter is osteitis pubis or infection and inflammation of the pubic bones, which is actually a very rare complication, and very very rarely death can occur in this particular procedure. One needs to understand any procedure performed anywhere in the body can carry a risk of death. That is, even for a simple lipoma excision, patient may die. Here again, because of the technicality and prolonged procedure, sometimes there can be a possibility of a death in 0.2 to 0.3%. Next, we will move on to the local complications associated with this procedure. There can be hemorrhage. Lot of hemorrhage can occur with this because this is a very vascular gland. BPH has very good blood supply. As you are aware, there is a lot of venous plexus. Plus, in the capsule, there are a lot of arterial supply. So when you are actually ablating or removing the gland, there can be small pinpoint bleeding you can observe from the surface that requires meticulous coagulation. If you don't achieve a good hemostasis, there can be hemorrhage. Second thing, suppose the surgeon is new and not completely aware of the situation, one can actually damage the bladder by causing bladder perforation, which can totally be avoided. Sepsis. This rarely can happen if you operate a patient who has some signs of prostatitis or prostatic inflammation. That is why we have to control the inflammation first, then operate on this prostate gland. Wound infection. Wound infection can occur basically in open surgeries. This is, we are talking about the open surgery, not for the endoscopic method. So first, all three complications can be totally prevented by achieving good hemostasis, by doing meticulous excision, undervision, and by controlling the infection. Few patients can have incontinence due to damage to the bladder support. Now, this bladder support sometimes can just fall if you core out too much portion from this. So that can just give way and can momentarily cause incontinence. Now, damage to the valve can also occur, which can cause retrograde ejaculation in the patient. Few patients may have impotence. Very rarely, these patients may have urethral stricture, that is narrowing, because the body will heal with fibrosis, the urethra will heal with fibrosis. So that can cause stricture formation in few patients. Then few patients will have bladder neck obstruction because either a clot getting retained at the bladder neck or some fibrosis. And very few patients will require resurgery or a reoperation for this. So majority of these complications can be prevented by doing a meticulous surgery under vision. See, time is not very important in these surgeries. You have to do it very thoroughly, methodically, so one can actually prevent these complications. Thank you.